sum that up for yourself? Like, what's the essence of who you are?
Easygoing, friendly guy who loves life and living life to the max.
I think there's a lot of people who just want to be just like that. At this point. Where are you originally from?
I was born and raised in Miami Beach, so I'm native.
Oh.
Yeah, I know, right? Very rude.
I know, you're a unicorn.
And then I actually was raised for the better part of my life in the Wynwood area. Now I'm in town, the art district in Miami. So, yeah.
So you basically kind of grew up with Miami's art movement.
I grew up when the place was just warehouses and factories. And when my friends and I would go and we vandalized the buildings with graffiti, although now it's considered art. And it's welcome, so yeah.
Wow, so you really witnessed the evolution of that area.
Indeed, yes. Major growth where one thing was not accepted and now it's totally accepted.
I think that kind of adds, do you think that adds to you as an artist, seeing that evolution?
It may. I haven't really stopped to think about that, but I'm sure everything in life impacts the evolution of the way of thinking. Trying to get to that next level, that next step of what you're going to do and expressing yourself.
Nice. Now, even though you're a Miami native, where's your heritage?
My family's from Puerto Rico. The city's called Camuy. That's where my mother's from. And my father from Quebradillas.
Nice. And I'm sure you visited, yes?
Very often. It's my little retreat just to get away from the chaos, the hustle and bustle of life. When I need a day or two to kind of unwind, I go visit my family, and they live in the countryside next to the ocean. So it's the best of every world because you have paradise, you have the simplicity of life, the nature, the beautiful colors of nature. It's perfect.
It's a perfect balance out to Miami, to be quite honest with you. So how did you get started as an artist, you know, being in Wynwood before it was Wynwood, and then having your Puerto Rican heritage, how did you get originally started in art?
Well, I was never exposed to art per se until like my family would do little outings here and there. And I think from there, I decided I wanted to be a fashion designer.
Okay.
So my influences were not Picasso, were not, you know, any of the masters. It was Chanel, Dior, until I actually started seeing the business of fashion design, and I didn't really care for it. So I actually bought a one-way ticket to go to Paris, and then a week later my money ran out, so I came back, and that's when I realized I did not want to be a designer. So I started incorporating a lot of the figures, and started expanding from that and getting away from that old fashioned thing and just evolving by deconstructing the beauty that tends to be fashion. So I kind of, you know, started incorporating a lot of the street elements, just being very loose with my lines and colors and designs, and it's led me to this.
Okay, now with fashion as an influence and kind of a starting point, and seeing as how now as an artist you've evolved, who's been your influence or idols as an artist? So I know you said that originally, you know, it wasn't Picasso or the greats, but as you evolved into art, do you have the artists that you look up to that might be one of the greats, or even a local artist?
There's so many artists. I did not mention Picasso. Again, that's one of the influences I would be lying to you, but Picasso has been a big influence. I love the Expressionist movement, so the Kooning has also been a really big influence. Aside from only Basquiat, can't leave him out of that repertoire.
Yes.
I mean, I think everybody's these days love Basquiat. He was so free and easygoing. So. And then there's a lot of the local, I think I gravitate more towards Cuban artists, although I have a Puerto Rican background, but I can actually understand a lot of what they're doing, because I see that within my own family, within, you know, my own family's person that I really appreciate and admire. And another artist that I just go goo goo gaga is Carlos Quintana. I love his work. Yeah, mind-blowing artist. So, and then I have one of my dear friends. She's just phenomenal. Although I'm a Mina too, so yeah.
That's mostly amazing to have somebody that you're close to also be an influence in your passion. I think that's super beautiful. Now, as far as art as a whole, as your profession, as your passion, where is it taking you? Because when I've seen you like on Instagram, you've been to like, you mentioned that you've gone to, of course, you've been to Paris, you've been to Puerto Rico, but where else is art taking you? Like, has it been for merely inspiration, or was it actually providing a showcase there? Where is the farthest that you've been with your art?
The furthest that I've actually shown my art, it's mostly within the state of Florida. That's where I kind of have stuck with. I have shown in California, though. There's a couple of galleries up there that I work with. So from the east to the west coast, I guess, two extremes.
In society, where do you see your place? Is it just as an artist? Is it as an influencer? Is it as an inspiration to other artists? Kind of where do you see your place in society?
I think I'm one of the millions of little ants in a ant's mom. And just doing my part, whatever that is. My outlet is art, and you know, thank you to all the people that have actually expressed their views. I think I've been touching some lives, young and old folks, so it's fantastic to see that. I think I paint for me, just to make myself happy, and you know, if I can bring it out to the world and for people to view it, critique it, admire it, appreciate it, acquire it, it's even that much more better. So I'm not looking for a spot in society. I'm just living.
Well, I think even just by living sometimes, that's an inspiration itself. Speaking of inspiration, has there been a piece of advice that you've received that's really resonated with you?
I think what I've picked up so far in my life is, and I'm going to quote Frank Sinatra, I did it my way.
classic quote. Very classic quote.
And I think, you know, having this passion for life, I tend to see the world the way that I want to see it. I tend to create a life that I want to create for myself. I take the good critique, the bad critique, but ultimately I decide how and what's going to impact me. Because it's my life ultimately. I have to live it. No one else is living it for me. And I think having come to that has actually made life so much easier, where you don't worry so much thinking of what people think of you. Even when I show my art, at one point, I would stand behind people just to listen. And some of the comments were really harsh. And I thank those people, especially when they hated the work. That made me stronger. And to the point where those same people can make the same comments. And it probably doesn't have that much more impact on me now. Because, again, it just made me a little bit more centered. I do welcome those comments though, because I don't know everything, and sometimes they may say things that I will pick up on, and they're absolutely spot on. And if something is not good, it is not good. And sometimes I don't see it, and it takes someone else to show me.
That is the most positive way I've ever heard someone talk about negativity towards like their artwork. You know, I think that's really empowering. And so for younger artists, what's some inspiration that you would want to leave to them?
Be humble. Know who you are, but be humble about it. Arrogance will get you nowhere. It doesn't open doors. It does not build bridges. It does not get you to shows. It does not get you to the collector's eyes. Just be humble, but be yourself too. This is a journey. It's not a one-stop shop, you know. You're not just going to show and that's it, you've made it, you know. This, I've been doing this going on 51.
Ooh.
And it's been a long, fantastic journey. I would not trade it. But it is a journey, and along the ways, I've learned to become more and more humble. Mm-hmm. And grateful. And I thank everybody who has actually met me in intersections in life.
Nice.
To have built who I am and who I am becoming, because the journey's not over.
Very much so.
Yes.
My personal dealing with the pieces, I had around four favorites. Control, Alt, Delete, that was honestly my first favorite, because you can kind of build, it's an art piece that you can attach meaning to in your own way. I think that's like the best type of art, because it's not subject to only one meaning by one person. And I think when you create art that is completely subjective, I think that's totally beautiful. I mean, I don't know what passions you have behind creating a piece, but I do definitely appreciate it. Selfie, which is art runs through my blood, or runs through my veins?
Runs through my veins.
Runs through my veins. That was one that grew on me. It's very Garcia feel, which I think is something that I often felt in a lot of the work that I had the pleasure of viewing. It gave me very Picasso meets Garcia type intersection, of course, with your own flavor.
And that piece, by the way, is a fun piece, because if you look at the image, it's actually in a meditative position. It's almost like an Zen theme.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm surrounded by my own art collection. A lot of the images behind me are actually works of art that I collected. So
wow.
If you've ever seen my collection, you get to see some of the images back there. And it's kind of the whole what gives me life, that oxygen that we all need to be alive.
Mm-hmm.
Art does that to me.
Wow.
So I think in that particular piece, I try to capture that. You know, without art, I don't have a life.
Another piece that I really connected with was Take Off My Head, or Cut Off My Head. It's black and white, and it was a head turned on its side horizontally, and it's mixed medium.
Yes.
It is. I've always seen it in TV, so I haven't seen it in person, but I actually really, really like that piece. And then I know I had another one out before that I really liked, but I started to gain an appreciation for the series, the political series that you did. And I definitely want to know kind of what started it.
You, as a human, me, everybody,
mm-hmm.
we cannot step away. We need to actually become part of, so that we can become part of the solution as well.
Mm-hmm.
We cannot allow others to decide for us, because the decision may not be the right one for us.
Mm-hmm.
So what I've done, last year I started creating a series that went around the subject of all the political issues, from the politicians, which I will refrain from commenting, to a lot of the political agendas that were going on and that are still going on and that will forever go on, because there's never going to be a happy medium. What works for one person doesn't work for the next. And what I started doing is that I started just picking different subject matters to incorporate into a drawing a day, pretty much.
Mm.
And I did this for 100 days, so dealing with a lot of the corruption that's going on, not only in politics, but in corporate America, unwed mothers, you know, the racial issue, the political issue, the religious issue, all the freedoms that we have, they're all issues. And in my drawings that I was doing, I was trying to capture some of those subject matters, and just kind of make fun of them, how at the end it really doesn't make sense, because we're here for a really short period of time on this earth, and although we should take action, and we should try to make things better, and love each other, and just be happy at the end of the day, because I think that's what everybody wants, getting angry and getting upset and hating people because they have a different view than you doesn't really resolve anything whatsoever. And that energy needs to be turned around. And I think if we took it a little bit lighter, you know, I love humor, so I tend to see humor in everything in life, you know, from the oddest thing to, you know, the most serious subject matter. I mean, you know, you might see see me giggle when somebody's giving a speech of a serious nature. And I think I try to make it a little bit easy to understand rather than getting too involved with that subject matter and just focusing on that, because every subject has such big array of other sub-subjects around it. So, in other words, everything's connected. And whether you're talking about, you know, the rights to whatever the issue may be, you have to look at the whole entire picture and how that one little subject impacts all these other subjects and so on. So, you know, it's a big picture, and I think we sometimes get trapped in this one little drop of water in this ocean. And I think that's when we become unhappy people, because we think that's it and there's more to life than those things. And that's what I did in these drawings, just try to capture a little bit of that with humor so that people can kind of relate to, but at the same time laugh and go home and, you know.
Nice. You're giving them a spoonful of sugar with the medicine.
Yeah.
Very so with that series of the, you actually did 100 drawings in 100 days, which I think is a challenge in and of itself. I know trying to balance life with your creative aspects and making an actual series. Do you think you'll be doing another series soon? Has there been anything to inspire some upcoming artwork collection that you might be able to get into?
Fantastic question. I didn't know this, but that is a good lead way to, I am actually series called Ngoma. It's an African word meaning dance. And that seems to have been a subject that touches me for as long as I can look back in my life. Being from Puerto Rico, I mean, there is an African element in, within the family somewhere along the line. And I am just gravitated, always gravitated towards African movements, the culture, the beauty, just sitting here looking at you, I'm thinking of the next thing I'm going to create.
Please let me know what that meaning is. I'll be like, oh, I was there when he was conceptualizing this piece.
So,
this is me. Some essence of me is in this piece. It's going to be awesome.
It is, and I'll definitely let you know, because the piece will probably be one of the primary pieces for an exhibit coming up in May and June this coming year, 2018.
My birthday's in June.
So you have to come down to the show and check it out. The whole subject is music, and part of the music that really attracts me is the motion, the movement. Because a lot of my paintings are dealing with motion. They kind of look a little blurry if you really look at them for too long. And the reason is I don't like for a person to sit there and model for me, you know, just look like kind of what we're doing now. And then I'll capture maybe a silhouette, and if you move, I paint over that silhouette over and over, where all of a sudden you may look like you have 20 faces, but you really don't. It's just capturing that movement, and then it becomes rather abstractive and expressionistic. But yeah, that's what I'm working on right now. And Ngoma, coming soon.
Coming soon. So that's my thing, is that we are really expressive year for you. I can already definitely feel it, and I cannot wait for that collection to come to fruition. With that being said, how can we see more of you? How can we follow you? Website, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, however you want the people to really connect with you. If you can just give that information, and definitely put the actual words running across the screen or maybe at the end in case they didn't catch it or if they just rewind it, however they want to do it. But definitely, how can people follow you?
Very easy. Instagram under Daniel Garcia Artist, and you will see every single day one, two, or more images of works that I'm creating, sketches, images from the past. It's pretty much a diary and a collection of my thoughts and my life in the art world, without getting a little too personal, but so Danny Garcia, Artist in Instagram, you can see all my work there and what's going to come and future ventures as well.
Awesome. Well, it has definitely been a pleasure talking to you. I'm excited about the upcoming year. I'm excited about the pieces that I've seen today. I'm excited to meet the man behind the art and actually know So it's been a pleasure hearing you, Garcia. Chatting up with you and actually getting to know the essence of who you are as a human being and as well as an artist.
Thank you. It's been my pleasure being here and sharing some of these insights of my life. And again, that Garcia, artist on Instagram. Mm-hmm. And I can't wait to share the painting that you've inspired me. That's right here right now.
So. Oh! You're like, guys, it's right here. Coming soon. Heritage is the legacy from our past, what we live with today, and what we pass on to future generations. This is, in essence, the essence of the exhibition that we're doing here called Afrique, and we will be showcasing, correct?
Yes.
Awesome. So, with that statement, with the essence of this exhibition, how did that factor into you as an artist and what you decided to showcase?
The title of the show, Afrique, is dear and close to me, because part of my heritage is African, somewhere on the line. I haven't learned that, the genealogy or anything, but I am sure because I see it in my relatives, and I even see it in myself and some features, but what I paint and what I create is a lot of times influenced by the African diaspora. And, you know, going back to my childhood where I lived in Wynwood, which is close to Overtown, I had tons of friends that were African Americans, you know, and it really wasn't an issue the way it is today. We were just one, we went to the same schools, everything was the same, we got along, there wasn't, I didn't feel there were boundaries, we were just one. And I think in my heart, you're able to see a lot of that. That it's not just a little bit of within me, but it's a lot of my surroundings, and it's really a lot of who I am. And it probably is going to be part of who I am forever. I actually use a lot of the colors that I see from the, I read a lot about National Geographic and stuff like that. So when I see a lot of the beautiful colors of the beings, like your necklace is beautiful.
Thank you.
But just colors of nature, I try to incorporate that into the works. I try to bring a little bit of the street, you know, the National Geographic, the family, the heritage, what I see in our society every day, and hopefully where we're going, you know, trying to bring a lot of the youth into the work to kind of let them see that it's okay, just create who you are, you know. I think if you try a little too hard and you try to make sure that things fall into the right place, you're not being true to yourself. You're not letting go as an artist, which is to express who you are. And in my art, I think I try to do that. I try to let go without really looking at all the little fine details. But if you step close to the piece, you're going to see a lot of fine little details. But I don't think about them as I'm putting them on, you know. You might see little markings here and there. And a lot of it is just maybe where I may have a little bit of paint in my finger and I just put it in there.
Yeah.
Just to paint my finger. But at the end, I think it all comes together. And the image itself talks about the joy, the happiness, the colorful that my life is. That's why my works are really bright. And in the show, in Afrique, you're going to see a lot of the colors, a lot of emotion. You're going to see a lot of me in those pieces, as well as a lot of who I become. I take things from everyday life that has influenced me and just kind of incorporate it. There's going to be a lot of plain words from my Spanish background as well, and then I take those words and kind of take a letter off here and there, or add a letter here and there, where in one language it may mean one thing, in another language it means something else, in another language it may not mean anything, but I play with those words, and you know, I have to reference back to Garcia. He kind of did that a lot too, and his rhythm was very poetic. I try not to do that, but I just play with the words as what they mean in our society, and how they become conflict to, you know, where, like, for example, in Spanish, A-L-A-I-A means over there, right? If you take one of the L's out, it's A-L-A, Ala, which becomes another culture, you know, it means God in the Middle East, and just things like that. You know, let's say, take the A out and just leave L-A, you have either Los Angeles, or the beginning to a song, La La La.
Yeah, very true.
So, just how everything, just the way we are connected, you know, you take one of us out of the picture and put someone else, and it changes the dynamic, and that's what life is. It's just constant change, and, you know, and we're all needed to become, to come together, to kind of create this beautiful world that we're living in.
I think that anybody who comes to that position is really going to get a full sense of who you are as an artist, and it's still going to tie in to the overarching theme of what African and heritage really is. How do you think art is going to evolve, being that our world is so connected now socially through technology, to be quite honest with you? So how do you think that's going to evolve how art is perceived, received, spread, and also how your art is received, perceived, and spread?
That is fantastic. I've actually seen the change from BP to BC, before computers, and before all these personal gadgets, it was difficult to get an image out there to the people. So I have seen it where I didn't have a cell phone. We didn't have, you know, the ease of getting an image out to the world in a second. And now I see how much I benefit from it. By putting a picture on Instagram, and within a millisecond, somebody's either liking or making a comment to the image across the world, in Russia or Japan or, you know, in Europe or even here within the States. So it's just mind-blowing. If we continue at this pace, I mean, we might be able to teleport an image to somebody's home. Like, imagine, you like it here, take it, press a button, and, you know, like in Star Trek.
That's a perfect image. That's a perfect image.
Yeah, and I think I see a lot of not life imitating art, but, or maybe, yeah, and it's intertwined. Life imitates art as well as art imitates life. And, you know, things that were not possible before, and a perfect example is FaceTime. Who would ever thought that we would have, you know, a little camera in front of our face and see somebody across the world. When I was growing up, I remember seeing the technology in Epcot. And I was like, oh wow, that's crazy. I was too young to have known better, otherwise I would have bought stocks. But the fact that I was able to press a button and somebody popped up in the image, in the monitor, and we were having a full conversation, that was mind-blowing. And then 20, 30 years later, it's common. It's just the way it is right now. So I am looking forward to seeing what the future holds for all of us, especially in the art, how we can bring art even to people's home that much more faster and just to the world in a much larger audience. So yeah, I guess we all have to stay tuned for that one.
But if we are able to teleport our pieces,
yes,
you heard it first here. So get that stock money ready. Get it ready.
I know it would be fantastic to have a show in this wonderful place, and for somebody who may be in their home in Switzerland or wherever the heck they're in, you know, in South Africa, all of a sudden say, "Oh, I like this. I think it'll go well here," and be able to kind of put the image where they see it. And all of a sudden, it's part of their collection. They own it. So that would be really interesting.
Nice.
Yeah. Let's see where that goes.
Yeah, let's see where that goes. Awesome. I think we got it.
Awesome. That was great. Thank you.